Hello students, this is Professor Sagar Birje and I welcome you all for the online class of analog and digital electronic. So in this class we will be discussing the examples on the Patrick method. So in the previous class you have seen the steps that are required in order to simplify the Boolean function using Patrick method. So what exactly is Patrick method? How we are going to use this Patrick method in finding out the minimum implicants for the given Boolean function? That is what we have discussed in my previous video. So in this video we will be applying those techniques of Patrick method in order to find out the minimum terms. So let us continue with the Patrick method. So basically when we talk about the finding out the minimum functions, we have the K-map, we have Boolean algebra, we have also discussed the Quinn-McCloskey method. So one of the disadvantage of Quinn-McCloskey method is that when the number of variable increases in Q-map, the prime implicant chart becomes complicated. Okay, and it's very difficult to determine the essential prime implicants from the prime implicants. So this is one of the disadvantages that you find when it comes to the Quinn-McCloskey method. So how we can overcome this problem of Quinn-McCloskey method using Patrick method, that is what we are going to discuss. So let us start with the example. So students, if you see the Patrick method, 50% of the problem is going to be solved using Quinn-McCloskey method only. Till we determine the tabular column for finding out the essential prime implicants, the steps are going to remain the same. So I quickly revise the given problem and then we'll more focus on the Patrick method that is going to be implemented after the tabular part what we have come up with. Fine. So let us already I have written a problem here. So let us take an example where we have only three variables. This is for our understanding of the Patrick method initially. So I have taken very less variables. So I have taken only a three variable Boolean function with the mean terms 0, 1, 2, 5, 6 and 7. So the mean terms are 0, 1, 2, 5, 6 and 7. So what is the first step in your Quinn-McCloskey method? The first step in Quinn-McCloskey method is to write down the binary notations for the given mean terms. So 1, 2, 5, 6 and 7. The binary representation of all these mean terms is given here. Okay, next. After noting down the binary representation of the mean terms, what is step 2? Step 2 is to group those mean terms according to the occurrences of ones in their binary representation. So here we can find I have grouped 0. In one first group is 0, mean term 0, because we have no ones present in this mean term. Then I have grouped 1 and 2. These mean terms contain only single ones. Then I have grouped 5 and 6 because these mean term contain two ones. And then I have a mean term 7 grouped because it contains three ones. So after representing the mean terms according to the occurrences of one, the third step is to compare those mean terms with the next higher order category mean terms. And if they differ by one bit position, so kindly note down into the next column and put a tick mark. Okay, and pair those mean terms which are differing by only one bit position. So the process already I have written. So in step 3, I have the mean term pairs and their binary representation. So if when I paired 0, 1, you could find there is a difference in the last column, that is in the third column. So 0, 0 underscore. So pairing of 0, 1 is done. So I have ticked 0 and 1. Next, it was 0 and 2. You can find there was a difference in the second position. So 0, 2 was the next pairing and 0 underscore 0 was the binary representation of those pairing of the mean terms 0 and 2. After that, I compared 1 and 2 with the next higher order category mean terms 5 and 6. So when I compared 1 and 5, you can find there was a difference in the first position itself, underscore 0, 1. Okay. So 1, 5 pairing was done. So I have ticked 1, 5. Next, 1-6, sorry, 1-6 was not possible because there was a difference of 2 bits. So 1-6 is not possible. Then it was 2-6. So when I paired 2-6, there was a difference of 1 bit position in column number, first column. So underscore 10 was the binary representation of that. Then I compared 5-6 with the next higher order category mean term 7. So when I compared 5 with 7, you could find there is a binary, there is a difference of 1 bit position in column number 2. So I have put an underscore there. So remaining term as it is, I have copied. When I compared 6 and 7, so there was a difference of bit position in column number 3. So you can find the remaining two columns I have copied as it is, and I have put an underscore in column number 3. Okay. So this is step number 3. Again, when it comes to step number 4, you can apply once again to find out if there is any further elimination of literal possible. So here when I compared 01 with 15 or 01 with 26, you can find there is no underscore present in the same position what 01 pairing has. So comparing 01 with 15 and 26 is not possible because it differs by more than one, and easiest way to compare is to find out the underscore in the same position and then further find out if there is a difference of 1 bit position in the next comparison. So again, 0-2 comparison is not possible with 1526. Why? Because you cannot find underscore present in the second position. So that is also not possible. Then I tried to compare 15 with 57 and 67, but I couldn't find the relevant underscore in the same position that when I'm comparing. Same thing is with 2 and 6. When I compared 26 with 57 and 67, so you can find there was no underscore present in the same position when I tried to compare. So possibility of further reducing of literals is not there. So we have to stop here. Then here step 4 mine comes is the prime implicant chart. So I have put the prime implicant chart. Here you can find there is a new term which I have noted down. This is required further. So what you do is list all the prime implicants. In this, the prime implicants are 01, 02, 15, 26, 57 and 67. There are no further prime implicants here because all the terms have been ticked. If there was any term which was unticked, you have to take it as a prime implicant along with the terms which are not getting eliminated further. Okay. So here you can see 01, 02, 15, 26, 57 and 67. These are the 6 prime implicants that we have. So I have listed down the prime implicants. For 01 it is A bar B bar, 02 it is A bar C bar, 15 it is B bar C, 26 it is B C bar, 57 it is A C, and for 67 it is A B. So here the only difference starts from here is what I have done is I have renamed all the prime implicants as P1, P2, P3, P4, P5, P6. Okay, you can write it as P, Q, R, S, T, U also. This is just a naming conversion given to this prime implicants so that I can represent this prime implicants with this label. So students, labeling is left to you. Now, further representation of the tabular column remains the same. So wherever I have listed all the prime implicants in the vertical column, and in the horizontal column I have represented all the mean terms which are given in the function. Fine. Later on, what I am going to do is I am going to put a cross in those mean term columns which are part of my prime implicant. So 01 is a part of my prime implicant. So 0 and 1 cross mark. P2 mein kya hai? 2 is there. 0 and 2 is there. I have marked it. P3 mein kya hai? 1 and 5. 1 and 5. P4 mein kya hai? 2 and 6. 2 and 6. P5, it is 5-7, 5 and 7, and P6, it is 6 and 7. So here you can find there is no, it is very difficult to find the essential prime implicants. We have listed out the prime implicants, but it is very difficult to find the essential prime implicants. So why it is difficult to find out the essential prime implicant? Because you cannot find a single cross in any of the column. Okay, the method for finding out the essential prime implicant is what? If okay, present in sorry, this, there is a single cross present in the column, then only we consider that as a prime implicant. Suppose this cross was not there, so my essential prime implicant was what? I would have marked this X as a round circle, and I had put I had used A bar B bar as an essential prime implicant. Suppose there was no X present here, then I would have encircled this cross and I would have written A bar C bar as my essential prime implicants. But in this problem, you can find that all the columns have more than one cross. So more than one cross. So how do we find the prime implicants? From here onwards, we are going to apply the Patrick method. To students, till here, hope you have understood the steps. Till now, whatever steps we have followed is the same that we have practiced in your Quinn-McCloskey method. The only thing what we have done is here is we have in the prime implicant chart, whenever we have prepared, we have labeled each prime implicant with some labels. Okay, we have labeled all the six prime implicants as P1, P2, P3, P4, P5, P6. Okay, so till here, hope the concept is very much clear. We are not able to identify the essential prime implicants. To identify the essential prime implicants, I am going to apply now the Patrick method. Fine? Okay. Now students, let us apply the Patrick method in finding out the essential prime implicants. So in continuation with the tabular column that I have prepared, okay. So I have listed out the prime implicants here, and I have labeled all the prime implicants. So my prime implicants are A bar B bar, A bar C, B bar C, B C bar, A C and A B. And I have labeled those prime implicants as P1, P2, P3, P4, P5 and P6. Fine. Now, next step is we need to write the function P. We need to write the function P, which includes all the mean terms. So all the mean terms 0, 1, 2, 1, 5, 6, 7, each and every mean term 0, 1, 2, 5, 6, 7, all the mean terms should be a part of this function P. So to include the mean term, okay, which is the first mean term what we have? Okay, we have the mean term. Okay, I will write down the mean terms. So the mean terms were, we had 0, 1, 2, 5, 6 and 7. Fine. So what we have to do? We have to write a function P which includes all the mean term. So which is the first mean term? It function P should contain all the mean terms means 0, 1, 2, 5, 6 and 7. So which is the first mean term? 0. So to include the mean term 0, to include the mean term 0, to include the mean term 0, we need to select CR. Now, if I want to include the mean term 0, okay, if I want to include the mean term 0, so in the function P, which are the terms I need to include? CR. 0 is present in this prime implicant A bar B bar, and 0 is present in this prime implicant A bar C bar. Can you find 0 in other prime implicants? No. It is 6, 7, 5, 7, 2, 6, 1, 5. So 0 is available in these two prime implicants. So I have to include the function P1 and P2. So the two prime implicants are, select the prime implicants are P1 plus P2. P1 plus P2. Why P1 plus P2? Because 0 is a part of those two prime implicants. So next one is to include the mean term. Next mean term is what? 1. So to include the mean term 1, we need to select the prime implicant which are the prime applicants. Now one is present where, you can check out here in the prime applicant chart table. So one is present in the first prime applicant P1, later on check out P2 mein nahi hai because it is 02, P3 mein hai, it is 1 and 5, so one is present here. So prime implicant P1 and P3 can be added, P1 plus P3, fine, P1 plus P3. So I have included 0, I have included 1. Now to include the mean term, which is the next mean term, 2. To include the mean term 2, we need to select the prime implicant. So 2 is present in which prime implicant? In P2, 2 is there, and later you can find in P4 the prime implicant 2 is present. So P2 and P4 can be clubbed. So I write here P2 plus P4. Understanding what I am trying to do? I am trying to include all the mean terms in my function P. So wherever these mean terms are present in those prime implicants, I need to add them. So next one is to include the next mean term is 5. Include the mean term for 5. To include the mean term 5, we need to select which all prime implicants? 5. Check out, 5 is present in which all prime implicants? 5 is present in P3, 5 is present in P5. So P3 plus P3 plus P5. So these are the two prime implicants that I am going to add to my function P, so that the prime mean term 5 gets added. So next is 6. To include the mean term, which one? 6. To include the mean term 6, we need to select the prime implicant. 6 kaha pe hai? 6 is present in P4 and P6. So prime implicant P4 plus P6 is going to be added. Similarly, the last prime implicant 7. Sorry, the last mean term 7. So to include the mean term 7, we need to select the prime implicant 7 kaha ka pe hai? It is present in P5 and P6. So P5 plus P6. Hope you have understood. So first process after formation of the tabular column, and if we are not able to get the essential prime implicants, we need to apply the next step, that is the Patrick method. In that, what I am going to do, I have labeled all the prime implicants, and we need to write the function P which includes all the mean terms. So my mean terms are 0, 1, 2, 5, 6 and 7. Fine. Now what I am going to do, to include the mean term 0, I need to select the prime implicant. So 0 kaha pe hai? Yahan pe hai prime implicant P1 and P2. So A bar, B bar and A bar, C bar usme hai. So similarly 1, 2, 5, 6 and 7. So this is how I select all the prime implicants, all the mean terms for the given function P. So I write P equal to, I am going to add all the product terms, multiply all the product terms, P1 plus P2, first one, P1 plus P2. So 0 is included in my function P. So mean term 0 is included through P1 plus P2. Next, to include the mean term 1 in my function P, I have to write P1 plus P3. P1 plus P3. To include mean term 2, I have to include P2 plus P4. To include the mean term 5, I have to include P3 plus P5. To include the mean term 6, I have to include P4 plus P6, and to include the mean term 7, I have to include P5 plus P6. Okay, till here the step is very clear. Fine. Next, now here we need to apply. So for a given function p, which is, you should be equal to, this should be equal to 1. Okay, means what? All the prime mean terms are included, then the function p is going to be 1. Fine. Now the next step is we need to apply distributive law. Now we need to apply distributive law. Distributive law kya hai? X plus y into x plus z is equal to x plus y z. Okay, remember this distributive law. X plus y into x plus z is equal to x plus y z on the given function. Okay, now find out wherever there is p1 term. P1 is present here, p1 is present here. So when I include, when I multiply this, when I apply this distributive law on these two terms, why p1 is common? Okay, because here see, x is common, y and z are two different terms, but in these two product terms what we have, x and x are common. So here p1, so I take this p1 plus p2 into p1 plus p3. So yahan pe x kya hai? X is p1 and y is y is p2 and z is p3. Fine. So iska answer kya aayega? X plus yz. What is x? P1. P1 plus yz kya hai? P2, p3. P2, p3. So I have applied the distributive law on these two terms, p1 plus p2 and p1 plus p3. So you find out the common terms in both the mean terms, and then you apply the distributive law. Next is which one you can find? Yes, here you can find p2, p4. The next bracket what you have is p2, p4, okay, and p4, p6. So here you can find p4, p4 is going to be common. So I include here which one? P2 plus p4, and p2 plus p4, check out, there is a common term p4 present in this bracket. So I say p4 plus p6. So p4, p4 is common in both the terms. So p4 kya aa gaya hamara? X aa gaya. P2 kya aa gaya? Y aa gaya. And p6 kya aa gaya? Z aa gaya. So what is the function? P4 plus p2 into p6. Okay, p4 plus p2 into p6. So p2 and p6 I have taken it as y and z, and p4 is the common term present in both the brackets. I have included the third mean term, p2 plus p4, and fifth mean term, p4 and p6. Okay, now which is the next remaining term? P3, p5, and here you can find p5, p6. Okay, so next one is p3 plus p5 and p5 plus p6. So obviously understood, p5 is the x term, p3 is the y term, and p6 is the z term. So I include p5 plus p3 into p6. Fine. So this is what we have got. So the final expression what we are getting is, what we are getting is here p1 plus p2 plus p3, p1 plus p2 plus p3, p1, sorry, p1 plus p2 p3, p1 plus p2 p3 into p4 plus p2 p6, and then it is p5 plus p3 p6. Okay, so this is what we are going to get the function P with all the mean terms included. Okay. So after representing all the mean terms in the given function P, which is true for all the mean terms present in the given function, I apply the distributive law, that is x plus y into x plus z is equal to x plus yz. So I first take P1 plus P2, P1 is the common term, so I represent P1 as x, P2 as y and P3 as z. So after applying the distributive law, I get the answer as P1 plus P2 P3. Similarly, P4 plus P2 P6, P5 plus P3 P6. Okay. Now, for the given term, what we have achieved here, what we need to do is apply the first term and remove the redundant term by applying the formula x plus xy is equal to z. That is the absorption law. So let me write the same term here. P is equal to P1 plus P is equal to P1 plus P2 and P3 into P4 into P4 plus P2 P6 into the last term P5 plus P3 P6. Okay, this is what we got after applying the distributive law for the given function P. So yahan pe kya karna hai abhi? Multiply first and multiply first and remove. We have to multiply this. Okay, multiply this and remove the redundant term by applying the absorption law, that is applying the formula. What is that formula? X plus xy is equal to x. Okay, so x plus xy is equal to x. This is the absorption law. Already we have discussed these steps in your previous class. So kindly multiply. Now what I am going to do, I am going to multiply this term P1 plus P2 P3 with P4 plus P2 P6. Okay, so when I multiply these two terms, now I am going to multiply this bracket with this bracket. Still I am not going to, I am going to keep the constant last term P5 plus P3 P6. So first multiply. So I multiply P1 with P4. So what happens here? P1, P4. Okay. P1, P4 plus P1 with P2, P6. Next term plus P1, P2, P6. Okay. Plus now the next term P2, P3 with P4. P2, P3, P4 plus P2, P3 with P2, P6 plus P2, P3 and P2, P3 with P2, P6. So P2, P3. P2 is common here. So here P2, P3, P6. So P2, P2. So P2, P3, P2, P6, P2 term is common here. So I will take either of the one. So P2, P3 and P6 are the term that I am going to get. Fine. So ye multiplication ho gaya. Once this is multiplied, then what I am going to do? I am going to multiply the term with P5 plus P3, P6. So after this, what I am going to do? I am going to multiply. So P1, P4 plus P1, P2, P6 plus P2, P3, P4 plus P2, P3, P6. I am going to multiply with the next term. Which is that next term? P5 plus P3 and P6. So now this Now, multiply each individual term of this bracket with the next terms P5 and P3, P6. So, let us multiply. Okay, let us multiply this. P1, P4. P1, P4, P5 plus P1, P4, P3, P6 P1, P4, P5 then P1, P2, P6, P5, P1, P2, P6 and P5, okay, then plus P2, P3, P4, P5, okay, then we have P2, P3, P4, P6 plus P1, P2, P3, P6 plus P2, P3, P4, P6 plus P2, P3 and P6. So these are the terms. What do you get? Okay, I will write it below only. Here I will write it. So P1, P4, P5, P1, P2, P6, P5. So P2, P3, P4, P5. So P2, P3, P6. So P2, P3, P4, P6. Okay. Then I will continue here. P2, P3, P4, P2, P3, P4, first one was P1, P4, P5, P1, P2, P6, P2, P3, P4, P5, P2, P3, P5, P6, plus P1, P3, P4, P6, plus P1, P2, P3, P6, plus P2, P3, P4, P6, plus P2, P3, P6. Okay, so we have to multiply these two terms. Okay, so I have P1, P4, P5 plus P1, P2, P6, P5. So P2, P3, P4, P5. Then P2, P3, P5, P6. So P1, P3, P4, P6. P1, P2, P3, P6, so plus P2, P3, P4, P6 plus P2, P3 and P6. So these are the terms that we are getting after multiplying both the brackets. So we need to eliminate the redundant terms. Okay. So we need to eliminate the redundant terms. So find out the redundant terms. So here we can find P2, P3, P6. So P2, P3, P6. So is there any other term which P2, 3 and 6? So here you can find 2, 3, 6. So 2, 3, 6 present here in these two terms. Okay. So what you have to do is note down. So after multiplying here, what you are going to do? Getting the redundant terms eliminated. So P2, P3, P6 plus P1, P2, P3, P6. So यहाँ पे क्या गया? Apply the formula, which is that formula x plus xy is equal to x. So how we are going to remove the redundant term? To remove the redundant term, we are going to apply the formula. First, we are going to multiply these two terms. Once we get all these terms, then I am going to remove the redundant terms by applying the absorption law, x plus xy is equal to x. So P2, P3, P6 is x plus P2, P3, P6 is again x and P1 is y. So x plus xy is equal to x. So I remain with P2, P3 and P6. P2, P3 and P6. Fine. So this is done. Now, once this is done, what do you have to do? Go with the next term. Now, which is the next term? You have to find P2, P3, P4, P6. P2, P3, P4, P6 with again 2, 3, 6. Again, you can find 2, 3, 6, 2, 3, 6 common. So here you can write now once again P2, P3, P2, P3, P4, P6 plus P2, P3, P6. Okay. So here, after eliminating these two terms, redundant terms, I get P2, P3, P6. So P2, P3, P6 remains the same. This term is getting cancelled. So now P2, P3, P4, P6. Now here you can see 2, 3 and 6 are common. 2, 3, 6 are common. P4 is the term remaining. So here, ये क्या हो गया हमारा y टर्म हो गया. ओके, सो y टर्म हो गया. सो ये बाकी सब ये x टर्म हो गया. x plus y plus x, इट इज अगेन गोइंग टू बी व्हाट? p2 p3 p6. सो दिस 4 इज टर्म्ड एज y हियर. सो p2 p3 p6. फाइन. Now eliminate the next term. So P2, P3, P4, P6 is getting eliminated. So now try to eliminate the next. Now P2, P3, P6 is again available where? So P2, P3, P6. So 2, 3, 6. Again it is available in this term. So this term also gets cancelled. So let me apply. So P2, P3, P5 and P6. So P2, P3, P5 and P6 plus P2, P3, P6 plus P2, P3 and P6. So iska answer kya hoga? Now this is termed as Y. Remaining term as this P2, P3, P6 will be termed as X. Aur ye X rahega. So answer kya hoga yahan pe? P2, P3, P6. So any further term that can be eliminated? If you see 2, 3, 6, kahan pe common hai? Yahan pe 2, 3 hai, lekin 6 nahi hai, 5 hai. Okay, so 3 hai, 6 hai, lekin 2 nahi hai, yahan pe bhi nahi hai. So further elimination is not possible. So we are remained with the 5 terms 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Okay, so let me write. We remain with 5 terms. So which are those terms? P is equal to P1, P4, P5 plus P1, P2, P6, P5 plus P2, P3, P4, P5 plus P1, P3, P4, P6, P1, P3, P4, P6, and the last term is P2, P3, and P6. Now, in this, we have to select the rows which has minimum terms. So here, the next step is, from the given function P, select the rows. We have to select those rows which has minimum terms. Which has minimum term. Now, which has the minimum term? Yahan pe agar dekho, so P1, P4, P5. How many terms are there? 3 terms are there. In this P1, P2, P6, P5, how many terms are there? 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 terms are there. So here also we have 4 terms. Here also we have 4 terms. So the minimum terms that are present are in this one, that is P1, P4, P5, and here P2, P3, P6. So we have the minimum terms P1, P4, P5. Okay. Or we have one more term. P2, P3, P6. So, in the final expression, we can have two different final expression. The final expression can be which contains the essential prime implicants. Okay, we have two essential prime implicants, two different functions with that can be considered, which can be P1, P4, P5, which has A bar, B bar plus B C bar plus AC. So P1, P4, P5. So come here, P1, P4, P5. It is A bar, B bar, B C bar and AC. That is one term. Or another EPI, what we have is the P2, P3, P6. So it represents A bar, C bar plus B bar, C plus AB. Fine. So this is how I get the final expression. And we have two different functions which we are getting with the essential prime implicants when applied the Patrick's method. So we have the two essential prime implicants P1, P4, P5, P2, P3, P6 with minimum terms. So we have to select those rows which has minimum terms. So minimum terms are P1, P4, P5, P2, P3, P6. Okay. So this is how students we apply the Patrick method in getting the essential prime implicants. Okay, so hope you have understood this method of applying the Patrick methods on a given Boolean function to find out the essential prime implicants, which is not possible to find out through Quinn-McCloskey method. So remember, the 50% of the problem till formation of the tabular method and determining the prime implicants is going to remain the same that we followed with Quinn-McCloskey method. Later on, we are going to apply the Patrick method in finding out the essential prime implicants, because it was not possible to find the essential prime implicants through the QM method. So in my next video, we'll be solving one more problem on the Patrick's method. Till then, you try to understand this method, and if you have any queries, feel free to text me and resolve your queries. Thank you, students.